Welcome to University Community Presbyterian Church. And if you'll read the front of your program, where we invite all to faith in Jesus Christ and growth in discipleship through word, prayer, and service. I also want to welcome with us this morning a special welcome to commissioned pastor Mary Ellen Lucas. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. There is a brief announcement from Muffy, a focus on mission. But Carol will go first. Please.
And you know what my brief announcement is. Women's Bible study tomorrow, 1 o'clock in the narthex. We're reading a very interesting book. You are more than welcome to come. We have free books, and we would hope to see you Monday. Oh, look, there's Donna Davidson. Monday at 1 o'clock.
Thank you, Carol. Muffy, now it's your turn.
See the raindrops? One great hour of sharing. Each one of those raindrops represents $100 that has already been contributed to this special offering. This offering has three things that the Presbyterian Church recognizes as important during the Easter Lent season. One is the self-development of people. Another is the Presbyterian Hunger Program. And the third is the Presbyterian Disaster Assistance. This offering helps all these groups throughout the year. There's more information out in the narthex on the bulletin board if you're interested in some of the groups that receive some of these monies, but prayerfully consider what you might be giving today during the offering time. Just put one great hour sharing, one OGHS in the memo section if you so choose, or you can use the envelope that has been provided in your bulletin. Thank you so much for this generous gift that this congregation gives every year.
If there are no other announcements, Mary Ellen.
Christ has risen.
Christ has risen indeed.
Christ has risen indeed. Please join for the call to worship.
Please stand if you're able. The call to worship this morning is from John 3, verse 17, and Psalm 46, verses 1 through 3. God sent Christ into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. God is our refuge and strength, a present help in trouble. Though the waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble with its tumult,
God's love endures forever.
Eternal God, in Jesus Christ, you have given the light of life to all the world. Sanctify this new fire and inflame us with a desire to shine forth with the brightness of Christ's rising, until we feast at the banquet of eternal light, through Jesus Christ, the Son of Righteousness. Amen. The hymn of praise will be on the screen and with our leaders.
Thank you.
day triumph for his foes. In the rose a victor from the blood domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, he arose, and renewed the Christ arose. Daily they watch his bed, Jesus my Savior. Daily they seal the dead, Jesus the Lord. Up from the grave he arose, he arose in the triumph of all his foes. He arose in the bomb, their victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, he arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. Death cannot keep his grave, Jesus my Savior. He tore the bars away, Jesus my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, he arose with a triumph, triumph for his foes. He arose with the rose, a victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever in the saints to reign. He arose, he arose, hallelujah, Christ arose.
Let us now turn our hearts toward God in our confession. This is a day of celebration, and nothing should prevent us from lifting our voices to praise God. We must not hide the things that we have done or failed to do. We must not let them fester, stifle our joy. Therefore, let us bring them before God in confession. Resurrected Christ, there is nothing we can do to deserve the grace you gave us. There is no way we can earn your love. There is no way we can be trustworthy or forgiveness. Yet you shower these mercies upon us. You have taken away the sting of death. Meet us where we are, in our doubt and our fear, our regrets and shame, in delight and awe. Meet us here in this place and call us once again to trust in you. God says to us, I have loved you with everlasting love. Therefore, I have continued my faithfulness to you. Christ says to us, do not be afraid. We need not fear. We are forgiven. We are loved. We are redeemed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, if you take time to share the peace to one another.
Well, I thought we were going to do Gloria Hopkins. Perhaps not. Yes, she did those.
You're certainly here, aren't you, Hiram? Anybody else? Oh, we've got two more. That's good. Come on up. Let's see. I see if I can sit down gently this time. Do you remember last time I nearly fell over? You do, yeah. Oh, there we go. Oh, we've got another one. Yeah, all right. So we heard Miss Muffy tell us about one great hour of sharing, didn't we? She was saying, yeah, what good things it does. You know, it's based on a gospel of Matthew chapter 25. And it says that if you do good things like feed the hungry, like clothe the people who need clothes, and like help people who are homeless, then you're doing this for God, and God thinks a lot, that's very good. And that's what the one great hour of sharing is doing. And all the people in the congregation here are contributing. Now, you know that we have a banner over there. Hey, what's it? You know where the banner is? It's over there, and it has these raindrops on it. We're going to update that banner. Do you want to come with me? We'll do that. Okay, let's go. Over here. Now, can anyone tell me how much one of these represents? Yes, how much?
$100.
$100.
Go put this one on over that side, which is for the kids. That's it. Who else wants to do one of these? Anyone want to put one on? Hiram, do you want to put one on? Here, you go put one on. Yeah. Here's. Did it fall off? No, not okay. We're going to have to give one to this little girl here. You can put one on. What happened to the one you tried to put on, Hiram? Oh. All right. Yeah? I know. We've only got... The trouble is... should I pretend we got another 100? That's better.
Prayer for illumination. Blessed Lord, who caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant us so to hear them, to read them, mark them, learn, and inwardly digest them, that we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which you have given us in our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Readings from the New Testament are from Acts chapter 10, verses 34 to 43, that you can follow in the Pew Bible, pages 129 or 30, or on the screen. Then Peter began to speak to them. I truly understand that God shows no partiality. But in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right and acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. The epistle reading is from Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. So if you've been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. And the psalmature reading is from Psalm 118, verses 1 through 2 and 14 through 24. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love, that is not what is on, there we go. Psalm, what is it? Yes, it's 118, 1 through 2. And 14 through 24. Now we'll wait to see what appears on the screen. It should be, O give thanks. If not, I'll read ahead. O give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Verses 14 through 24. The Lord is my strength and my might. He has become my salvation. There are glad songs of victory in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. I shall not die, but I shall live and recount the deeds of the Lord. The Lord has punished me severely, but he did not give me over to death. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Today's gospel reading is from Matthew 28, 1 through 10. Now, after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the sepulchre. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat upon it. His appearance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angels said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen. As he said, come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead, and behold, he was going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. Lo, I have told you." So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to tell the disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, "Hail!" And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. And Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brethren to go to Galilee, where they will see me." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Christ has risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Let us rejoice, for Jesus is alive and his spirit is with us as we sing and praise God's holy name this Easter Sunday, a day when we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Even though we were not present for that first Easter morning, each of us have been changed by it. Because of his resurrection, the world was and will never be the same. I'd like you to close your eyes and visualize what it must have been like that first Easter morning. How different it was then. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary didn't greet one another with such great joy and hallelujah. No notes of joy, just hush whispers. They were grieving and devastated. Their world was turned upside down. They had seen their beloved Jesus, their teacher, stripped not only of his clothes, but of every possible shred of human dignity, murdered in the most horrible way possible and laid in a garden tomb. So many questions must have been swirling around their heads. He said he was the Son of God, but look what has happened. Why? Matthew tells us that the women got up early and went to the tomb to grieve, perhaps just to sit quietly and recall the love Jesus had shown them. Never in their wildest imagination had they dreamt of what would have happened next. Matthew gives the detail of what happened. There was a great earthquake and it rolled away the stone. And the angel, his appearance was like lightning and his clothes as white as snow. The earthquake was not just a general tremble, but a violent, earth-shaking one. If any of you have experienced one, imagine a lot of us Alaskans have. Perhaps this is symbolic of the way Jesus' resurrection would rock the whole world and shake up our understanding of Jesus' power over death. Yes, the resurrection would shake up the world's understanding of Jesus and who he was and how he came to the world to die to save all people and to rise again. Can you imagine what that must have been like? The stone wasn't rolled away to let Jesus out. He had already risen. It was rolled away so the Marys could look inside and see that the tomb was empty. Matthew, unlike the other gospel writers, doesn't tell us if the women actually went inside the tomb, but they were filled with fear and awed at the power of God. They ran with joy and excitement. As far as Matthew is concerned, they didn't need to look inside. They believed the impossible. Jesus was dead. Now he's alive. And he's alive now. The resurrection touches and moves us deep down inside. It changes us. We encounter God's wonder, that feeling of surprise, joy, excitement, and hope, and awe aroused by something strange and unexpected. The words of the angel had instantly made a change in the women's lives, their whole outlook of who Jesus was and what he achieved was reversed. Their fear of death had been changed to hope. The resurrection happened about 2,000 years ago, and it has changed the way we look at the future. The greatest threat we face as human beings is death. The fear of death controls our lives much more than we realize. The fear can dictate what we eat, what activities we engage in, where we live. The fear of death makes us attentive to every ache and pain in our body. But the resurrection of Jesus takes the teeth out of death. The sting is no longer there. He defeated it. It shows us there's life beyond the grave. Death is no longer a giant. It's a mere blip on the screen of eternity. Jesus' return from the grave allows us to face death with new confidence. We understand now death is just passing from life to a world to life in eternity. Death shall not have the last word in your life or mine. What happened to us as children of God when we die is certain. Unlike a football game, we're unsure of the outcome till the last minute. We may have some doubts about what paths our lives may take, but in the end of the game of life, we know for certain and sealed for us living in Christ. The resurrection happened 2,000 years ago, but it has changed the way we look at the past. Does your past haunt you? Do you worry that God knows what you're really like? Are there past deeds that you feel God would have a hard time forgiving? Do you fear some of your decisions would come back to haunt you? If so, you're not alone. When Jesus rose from the dead, he proved that the sacrifice of his life on the cross was acceptable for all our sins. Jesus is our living Lord. If he had stayed dead, then his death would have been any different than anybody else. But his death was for our sin. And his resurrection showed the debt paid for the past sins. Peter said, through Jesus' name, everyone who believes will receive remissions of sin. The New Testament connects us to Jesus' death and resurrection. Apostle Paul says, if we are buried, therefore, with him through baptism to death, that's just like Christ raised from the dead through the glory of the Father. So we also might walk in newness in life. Our past may embarrass us. People may judge us and think badly about us. God has dealt with our past. The resurrection not only happened 2,000 years ago, it has changed the way we look at life today. It has changed we look at the present. People suffer from all sorts of trauma, of being made redundant, throwing off to the scrap heap after years of faithful service. Some suffer in continual pain of broken relationships, and the pain so intense that it seems will never go away. People suffer abuse and poor health, mental problems. Death is an ever-present reality. Some feel the pain of grieving, the pain that never seems to go away. I don't want to minimize the suffering, but Easter declares that pain and evil do not have the last say. Our Savior is a living Savior, a resurrected Lord, has promised that he would walk with his disciples and us through all our days in this life. He is ready to use his power on all circumstances. He gives us courage when our knees wouldn't buckle. Our resurrection Lord gives us new hope, sustains us, recreates us in circumstances that would seem to be the most hopelessness. The resurrection is about life. It has changed the way we look at life today. I read online about a village in Paraguay named Caturia. I can't pronounce, excuse me. An impoverished area in which the villagers survive by recycling items from the rubbish dump. The village is actually built on a landfill. From these terrible, uncompromising conditions, something beautiful has emerged. It's called the Landfill Harmonic. A documentary was made about them in 2015, and you can view them on YouTube. The orchestra crafted its own instruments from their garbage. Violins are made from oil cans with bent forks for keys. Cellos are made from drums with tiny wooden rollers for tuning pegs. I listened to them play on YouTube, and it was unbelievable to hear Mozart played on these instruments. Violins from landfills, music from the slums. The director, Fabio Chavez, quoted saying, "The world sends us garbage. We give them music." I believe this can be a metaphor for what God has done through us through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. One of our youth went to a mission in South America to just such a place. And this is a cross made from recycled, I believe it's newspaper, but they've done all sorts of neat artwork out of the trash. Because of his resurrection, God has taken the landfills of our lives and the waste and the mess and the stink of our lives, has created something new and beautiful. Like this orchestra, God has made a symphony of beautiful music through praise and testimony to his glory. out of our redemption made possible through Jesus Christ. Satan tries to fill our lives with the world's garbage, but God transforms it into a new creation. We all have a testimony how God has taken the bad stuff in our lives, the hurt and the pain and sin, the failures and bad habits, the impoverished areas of our character and personality. Yes, God has taken all of that and transformed us to a new creation. The tomb is empty. He has risen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, today we are presented with momentous news. The one who died on the cross has been raised. The tomb is empty. Death is undone. Open our hearts and our minds that we might see what you have accomplished through the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Turn to the UCPC handbook or follow the screen for the hymn of affirmation, In Christ Alone.
First cry to final breath, Jesus
let us state our faith as the church all around the world have done. We trust in Jesus Christ, human, fully God. Jesus Christ proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor and release
to the captives,
teaching by word and deed, blessing the children, healing the sick, and binding up the brokenhearted, eating with outcasts, forgiving sinners,
and calling all to repent and believe the gospel.
Unjustly condemned for blasphemy and sedition, Jesus was crucified, suffered into the depth of human pain, giving his life for sins. God raised Jesus from the dead, vindicating
his sinless life, breaking the power of sin and evil,
delivering us from
death to life,
eternal life. Call for the offering. Okay, let us reply through the doxology. Oh, sure.
For offering, we have three plates at the entrances to the church for you to place your offering or send it forward through PayPal or whatever the means. So we have a brief period for you to do this and followed by the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him all creatures here below. Praise him.
merciful Father, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Restore them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
We'll take prayers of the people after communion.
Okay. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We lift them up our hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord, our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Eternal God, holy and mighty, it is truly right and our greatest joys to give you thanks and praise and to worship you in every place where your glory abides. You have surrounded us with a great cloud of witnesses, saints and martyrs, faithfully people in every age that strengthen by their witness and supported by their fellowship. We may run with great perseverance the race that is set before us, and with them receive the unfading crown of glory. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with the heavenly choir and with all the faithful of every time and place who ever sing to the glory of your name. Holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, the earth, Hosanna in the highest. Comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are holy, O God, of majesty, and blessed is Jesus, your Son, our Lord. You sent your only begotten, into whom your faithfulness dwells, to be for us the truth and the life. Revealing your love, Jesus taught those who would hear him. Heal them who believe in him. Receive all who sought him and lift the burden of their sin. We glorify you for your great power and the love at work in Christ by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection. You gave birth to your church, delivering us from the slavery of sin and death, and made us a new people by the water and the Spirit. We give you thanks, Lord Jesus, for on the night that he died, he took the bread and he broke it, saying, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me, for we are many people, but we are one body." And in the same manner, he took the cup. This cup is a new covenant sealed in my place by my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of sin. Whatever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. Remembering almighty and merciful acts, we take this bread and this wine, the gifts you have given us, and celebrate with joy and thanksgiving. Accept our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving as a living, holy offering of ourselves. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. The gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon your gifts of bread and the wine. And the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and the blood of Christ. By your Spirit, unite us with the living Christ and all who are baptized in his name, that we may be in one ministry in every place. As this bread is the body of Christ, send out to be a body of Christ, through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor to you, eternal God, now and forever. The feast of the Lord is offered here. Gracious gifts of his precious love. And this cup blessing is shared within our midst. He is present with us. Let it be a foretaste of all that is to come. The bread has been broken. The wine has been poured. The banquet is prepared. The Lord is our host, and we are his guests. All are welcome at the table of our Lord. Communion assistants, come forward.
If you would start from the front of the church, the first rows from the left, from your left to your right, going toward the back of the church.
Blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you.
Before the Lord's Prayer, we have an opportunity to express our joys and concerns and to bring these forward before the Mary Ellen gives us the leads us in the Lord's Prayer. From the those who wrote comments, we have joys for the risen Lord. A joy that Patty is so much better after being in the hospital this week. Joy for a good trip visiting family. And special joys for people returning after being down south in the winter. Are there additional joys and concerns? Yes, Laura. I didn't hear that.
Who was the long-term chaplain at hospice?
Okay.
He unexpectedly died last night.
Okay.
And I can't even begin to talk about what he means to the team at hospice and to all the patients and their families, plus his wife. I mean, the team at hospice would be grieving seriously while they're still trying to take care of patients and do everything. He was just everything to everybody. He could meet anybody from any country.
Okay.
And then on a whole other level, I have a friend whose family lost a dog very unexpectedly, traumatically, and tragically. And the whole family is grieving hardcore, especially the 22-year-old who found the dog, his her dog, that was found dead unexpectedly. So and then I had a joy. My nephew, who I've asked prayers for before, who's been homeless and addicted in Portland, my sister-in-law was able to find him and spend some time with him recently. Get a picture of him and to let us know she found him and spent time with him. We'll take whatever we can get, so we'll consider that.
Okay. Are there other joys or concerns? Yes.
Yeah, I'd like to ask for prayers for a friend of ours, for her family and her friends, Nancy Graff. She was a leader in the agricultural community here in the Fairbanks area. She was diagnosed with cancer at the beginning of this week and passed away yesterday. Total shock to everybody that knew her. So I'd like to ask for prayers for her and her family because I know that everybody's in shock.
Okay.
The name again was Nancy Graff.
Nancy Graff. Okay, thank you. Are there other joys and concerns? Yes. Randy.
Well, I'm told that Durkan fell on February 1st, and after spending 4 days, 5 nights in the hospital, came home, and thanks for a lot of prayers, some coming from the bunch of people, she is pretty much recovered. She's doing great. The only thing she's not doing is driving, which
Roger.
Many of you know about the Sweet Adelines, who actually they practice here every week. Gail Miller, who was their director for many years and had a short period in hospital last week, unfortunately.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
When my people in my village passed away, who was only 27 years old, and it was unexpected, so it was a couple of weeks ago, so I didn't see him come here. So here's for his family, and his name is Douglas.
Thank you. Any other joys and concerns? We then send forward these joys about Laura's nephew Jay in Portland and in a rehabilitation process. We send forward the joy of Georgiana's recovering so quickly from her fall and her 4 or 5 day stay in ER. We then send forward Laura's prayers for a long-term family friend who died in hospice, and especially prayers for his spouse. We send forward prayers about the loss of a dog companion who was found and in a tragic death. We send forward from the Illingworth about Nancy Kraft, who had been diagnosed with cancer and who passed yesterday unexpectedly. So quickly, and acknowledging her contributions to agriculture in Alaska and to 4-H. We send forward prayers to those who followed the leadership of Sweet Adeline's and the leader who had been diagnosed recently and then passed away unexpectedly. And we send forward prayers for friends in families who have passed and left us bereaved, but leaving us in Christ's hands. And we ask Pastor Mary Ellen, commissioned pastor, to lead us now in the prayers and the manner of prayer taught to us by Christ. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our next hymn is Jesus Christ is Risen Today. Hallelujah. Thank you.
Christ is risen today. Alleluia, our triumphant holy day. Alleluia, who did once upon the cross. Alleluia, suffer to redeem our lost.
Christ the Lord has risen on this beautiful day. Let us take his resurrection hope with us as we leave. And may the grace and love of our Jesus Christ be with you all. Now go in peace and serve the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
God be with you till we meet again. By his counsel guide upon you, with his sheep securely fold you. God be with you till we meet again.
I only know that she was in hospital because of a heart problem and breathing problem. And I think she was transferred to the Denali Center, and that's where she died. I think she was probably in her 70s, I would think. Keep these.